Welcome, everybody. I'm Brian Gilman. I'm a Vice President of Solutions Marketing here at Vonage, and I am moderating our session today on optimizing the balance between customer experience and ROI. I think you've heard throughout the keynotes earlier today that there's a heavy focus today in the market on CX, and in our acronym soup of CX, ROI, CPaaS, what else are we gonna cover? CPaaS, CCaaS, UCaaS. We'll hit them all today.
Bunch of asses, yeah.
A lot of asses, yes, yes. Thank you for taking that one, Jay. I appreciate it. So today with me, I have three panelists here. I have Jay Patel, who's our Chief Product Officer at Vonage. I have Sheila McGee-Smith, who is the Founder and Principal Analyst. That was, look at that, your name precedes you. And we have Ken Kutlarik Jr. Wait, come back, we can kick her off. No.
It's okay.
And we have Ken Kutlarik Jr., who's the Customer Service Operations Manager for MTD Products. Okay. I didn't get a round of applause from me. All right. At any rate, thank you, Greg, I appreciate it. I wanted to level set this conversation today. Sheila and I kicked off this topic a couple weeks ago when we were trying to frame out what this session was gonna be. We spoke earlier about, the gentleman from Salesforce was speaking about the explosion in CRM, and we were talking about the need for CX. What has fundamentally changed in probably the past couple of years that is really bringing communications back to the forefront of being a transformational engine to customers today?
So if you would bring up my first slide.
I can do that.
So as we were talking about this, this article was in the Wall Street Journal, October 19th, 2019. So it can't be more recent, more relevant, right? And it's an article about, you know, the title is self-evident, the phone call isn't dead, it's evolving. And Yahoo researchers, trying to figure out how teens were communicating, asked some teens in the San Francisco Bay Area to keep a diary of how they communicated with their mobile phones. And they were able to compare it to data that they had collected in 2012, 7 years ago, okay? In 2012, 94% of people reported they had used their mobile phone to make a phone call. Okay, seems fair, right? 2019, that had dropped to 45%. And those of us who have smartphones and know how we use them know that that's not unusual. I mean, I can go a whole week and not use my mobile phone to make a phone call. So what does that mean, right? So how often have we heard in the contact center space, voice is still important? Okay, I'm not gonna debate that voice is still important. I think hiding behind voice is still important means you're not doing enough in the other channels to catch up with the way people communicate every day and wanna communicate. So if you'll kick to my next slide, Brian.
Making my job easy.
Right. So this is a quote from that same article. And to me, it speaks to the need for contact centers, for customer experience, to start supporting persistent communications, right? We had a great example of, my husband and I just moved to a new house. We moved with our same entertainment provider, because I'm not gonna slam the provider. I could, but I won't, because somebody told me not to. No, okay. But we were staying with the same provider and just moving house in the same state. I mean, it's not a big deal, right? My husband spent 3 hours on the phone with this provider, with a call center, because they had made an appointment to show up at between 8 and 11, and just never showed up and never called, right? And so in a persistent communications world, he might have been able to present his issue and somebody would own it and go figure out what happened and then figure out how to fix it, right? But we don't live in a world where contact centers can do that. You either stay on the phone or they can't call you back or they can't text you or they can't this or that. And so to me, what has fundamentally changed is how we all communicate and the fact that contact centers haven't caught up as much as they need to. So my next slide. So for me, the thing where CRM and CX can come together and make life better. So what do we want to do? We want to move the needle, right? We're not going to change everything overnight. So how do we just begin to move the needle? And I think one way is with more proactive communications. We have the data, right? We have the technology. I've been saying this actually for a couple of years. The thing about proactive communications is there are times when they know something that you don't know. And at some point, you're gonna have to call them and ask them, but if they know you don't know and you need to know, just tell us. In this particular case, going back to my entertainment provider, they had put the order on hold because there was some issue with how many 4K machines my husband needed to have in a house. So apparently some limit was reached, and so they put it on hold. But they didn't tell us, and they didn't call us, and you know, because there was a fix, right? A 14th satellite. I'm not sure what the fix is, but you know. But proactive communication is about using the data we have. And when you think about it, when we get those alerts, we love them. I know I do. When the dentist reminds me it's been 6 months, it's time to come in for a cleaning, first I curse, and then I say, okay, I'll go do it. You know? So I think what's changed is we have the data, we're not using it as well as we can, and the expectation levels have really risen.
So when we spoke a while ago, we were talking about, I think the original thought that we had was to tie CX and ROI together, and you came back and said, not really, because a lot of times CX and ROI actually they're confrontational in some manner. I want you to talk about that really briefly, just to kind of talk, because we call this optimizing the balance between CX and ROI. I think it'd be really important for these people to kind of hear your thought process through that.
Right. So my concern with using ROI is it leads us down a path we don't necessarily want to be led down, right? It leads us down a path of, I have 400 agents, and to optimize 300 would be better. So let me force people to IVR, right? And that could be a short-term fix, right? We could automate more calls. We could put out a chatbot, and we can automate more calls. But not done well, and not done with all of the context and delightful experiences, you end up in the long term actually decreasing ROI because you lose customers. They drop. And so your goal of saying, oh, technology is going to help me and I'm going to have fewer agents, that's not the goal. The goal is you have to lead from delight. And I'd like to actually take your job right now and kick it to Ken.
Fine, I'm just going to say it. You got it, Sheila. Go ahead.
Ken is in charge of the contact center at MTD, okay. And I've actually spoken to them in the past. Yep. We did a white paper together when he was a new voice media customer. But talk a little bit about this balance and how you feel about automating, because you're a B2B business primarily, right?
B2B, B2C, yeah.
We introduce your business too.
Okay. Sure, so MTD is an outdoor power equipment. We're a worldwide leader. So lawn tractors, snow throwers, tillers, any kind of lawn and garden equipment we pretty much make. Big brands, Cub Cadet, Troy Bilt. We do a lot for Craftsman as well. I'm sure you guys have all heard of all those. So
they're in the garage somewhere.
We're in the garage. You got it. Yep. And we make tall grass short.
Yeah.
Right. Or we move snow. So we sell to mass retailers. We sell to our independent retailers through Cub Cadet, and then direct to consumers. And you know, as you're talking about, you know, this ROI versus, you know, customer experience, the experience has taken over, right? So back in the day, the retailers had all the power, right? Well, the brand had the power. The retailers then took it over, and now it's the customer. They have it, right? I mean, just think about social media. They can put something out there. It could really hurt you or help you. So if you're not in all of the channels that, you know, make sense for your business, you can't really optimize your ROI for that experience. So phone calls, everybody, you know, that's your basis, right? But chat, it's one of the leading or growing, fastest growing channels out there. You know, social media, we just took that on from a contact center standpoint in April, and we're seeing it, you know, grow leaps and bounds for us.
On the consumer side or the, or both?
Consumer, mostly consumer. We'll post out there for something on a brand, and we'll get all kinds of posts back and responses, and we have a team that can respond back to those individuals. And you know, it makes a difference how quickly you respond, right? So that's a big piece too, is if you don't have the right people in the right places at the right time, it could, you know, change your customer satisfaction immensely.
I'm going to run some more of this, by the way. So, Jay.
You do your thing. Go ahead.
I know the product really well. I know the customer really well. So, what's new for MTD, right? You've been a customer 2.5 years or something?
Yeah.
I know this. Is your side of it, right? The Vonage side, right? So, what are you going to offer him to make this even better, right? Because you're happy, right? You're happy. People who aren't happy don't do white papers with analysts. It's a pretty fair statement. I don't want to write that white paper, and they don't want to do that. But
yeah, so a few areas where, you know, just stepping back on the ROI versus CX, again, if you do right by the customer, get their issues solved, the ROI is going to come. If you have happy customers, that's the most important thing you got to think through. And some of the tools we can bring to our customers are, first of all, what's evolving now is customers just want their problem solved, and that agent may not be the only person that can solve that problem. In many cases, they may need to pull in other employees in the corporation to help them solve that problem. One of the things that now bringing in all these assets within Vonage, we're gonna like seamlessly blend employee communications with agent communications. Many of the most leading companies that are around CX, everybody in the company is responsible for customer experience, not just, you know, the service or sales, or everybody should be fundamentally accountable to the customer. And making that communication really simple, the use case is customer calls in an agent can't solve the problem. Agent needs to contact an employee to help get the expertise to solve it, but they're on different systems. But today, with Vonage, you can have them on the same system where the agent could say, well, employee X is busy on another call, but employee Y is available, I can see his presence, let me pull him into this conversation so I can quickly resolve my customer's issue.
So look,
that
at
is
this.
Really the most important way to
so
solve
now
it.
We have a vendor telling his value prop, right? And we have a customer who can respond. How does that sound? This is great. I love this.
This is fantastic, right? So anytime you can
collaborate. We're supposed to be working together on this panel.
I'm hoping this works for you, but if it doesn't, you know.
So collaboration is key across, you know, business units and different departments. And if you can put that all into one platform, it's a no-brainer, right? So.
Excellent.
Makes sense.
So are you still on premises for your UC? Or yeah, you are.
Skype, yeah.
Nice, you're the perfect opportunity. There's a reason he's here.
We've had those discussions. Well, started them, yes.
Right, but that's one of the things that happened, right? Mm-hmm. The cloud, because of CX and because of how CX has changed, companies looked at their infrastructure and said, okay, I can leave that dial tone there for a bit, but I got to change my contact center. And that's probably what happened with you. It's like you couldn't let the contact center stay, so the CCaaS market took off faster. But now people are saying, okay, now I want it all to be that good, right? Excellent.
Yeah, especially on the contact center side, one of the advantages we had was the fact that we're integrated with the data with Salesforce. And that's, you know, I'll use my own example of an entertainment company. this literally happened to me. I had two issues. I had a problem with my mobile phone provider and a problem with my entertainment company. I called both of them on the same day. The entertainment company was a series of IVRs. You know, what's your account number? Who are you? What's your problem? Like three times they asked me. The phone company knew who I was because obviously I was calling from my mobile phone. They immediately knew what my issue was, and there was no IVR. I got to a person, I resolved my issue 5 minutes off, I'm done. With the other one, I'm on the call for an hour. And that data of bringing that Salesforce or CRM data into that agent so they know exactly what they're calling about. They don't have to ask you. I read one of our competitors put a post up and saying, build an IVR, a menu tree, a phone menu tree. And the first line on social media response was, the customer says, I hate menu systems on an IVR. I actually don't want that. I want my problem solved. And a menu system is just causing me delays to get my problem solved. And so those are some of the things that we're going to continue to improve on, is how do we enable these agents to really solve their customers' problems.
The easy answer is to cut the cable. Just throwing it out there. We can talk about it later. I wanted to take on another topic. Last night we had Ken Jennings give his presentation. For those of you who weren't here, he was the
who was there?
Winner.
Who lost on Jeopardy?
It was so fun. It was so fun.
So Ken was here, and he was talking about his experience when they asked him to challenge IBM Watson in a round of Jeopardy. The whole concept of AI, you can't go anywhere without somebody saying that they're deeply involved in the AI space. How is AI starting to impact this world of CX? Where do you see the benefits, and where do real-time communications play in all that?
Okay, so let's do a couple of slides.
Oh, wait.
You forgot them. Yeah, you forgot about the slides. Yeah.
I didn't forget about it.
That's why I'm here, Brian. You know. Okay, so why are we talking about AI now? Right? AI has actually been around for like 50 plus years. I mean, I think of the first big AI as breaking the Enigma code, right? Alan Turing, back during the World War II. And this is turned toward Brian, my slide, so whatever. Just sort of pulse through it. But one of the things is that the enablers have come along, right? There's an animation, Brian, if you could just pulse through it.
Yep.
Oh, I'm sorry, you're doing it. And if you look at all of these, the biggest enablers, in my mind, and I want you to chime in here, is computing power and cloud.
That's right.
Right? Because even Ken Jennings last night, one of the things he talked about is Jeopardy is always filmed in Culver City, California. Okay, fine. But they couldn't do the Watson trial there, the Watson shows. They had to recreate a soundstage in New York at IBM headquarters, because that's where Watson was. And he showed a picture, and he goes, the only Jeopardy champion he's always, right. Anyway. So huge, you know, what we know of as IBM mainframe type of look and feel. And so cloud computing combined with computing power,
right.
I think has been the key to AI. Because you need a lot of power to do this stuff, but you...
Yeah, and I'd add a third on that was high-speed networks, the internet, to get access to that data. I remember in the early years of VR, everybody probably had those Bluetooth speakerphones or their phones where the models were actually in the device itself. They were not in the internet and couldn't leverage the power of all the models that you can have. You can have a lot more data because the information is stored in the cloud. And by having that access, you can build more robust systems. One of the things we have is a product in our product called Conversation Analyzer. But we know it didn't work with all the dialects. If you're a person speaking English, but you might have an Asian dialect or a different dialect, now we can tune for all these because we have enough data to build it. If you had to put all that intelligence in the physical device, the quality would just never be there. So the cloud computing power, the speed of the internet, how quickly that's advanced has allowed us to really make robust solutions that can really solve the problem for any customers.
And that's why Siri doesn't work if you're not connected
right.
to the
internet.
Interesting, right. Interesting. Bring up the next slide. The other thing that I think about AI, please.
All right.
You know what's funny is I have a brother named Brian, and I'm sort of channeling that right now.
I was going to say, this answers
a lot. And he's not my older brother.
This answers a lot. That's what I'm gonna say.
I don't have a brother named Brian, and I treat him the same way. You do today, so.
Yeah, you do. Yep.
So this slide is about the use of intelligent automation in different vertical industries, right? And to the far, my far, whatever, over there, those are the industries that started first. 4+ years ago, the amount of activity in terms of intelligent automation was in the usual suspects in terms of verticals, banking, insurance, financial services. And then, you know, more recently, the last couple of years, telecom, healthcare, travel, and then even in the last year or so, we're seeing pro services, government. And the reason I bring this up is when you live in the contact center, right, and customer care, you think, oh, AI is coming and this is brand new stuff. In fact, AI is pervading all of the business that you're in. So when we were talking earlier, I asked Ken, is AI being used in your business? And the first answer he gave me was, yes. So I'm going to let you actually give your own answer.
Sure.
Look at me, you know, giving up the mic.
Yeah, no problem. So, yeah, within MTD, we use a lot of robotics for welding and manufacturing purposes. The automated guided units that take a frame down the assembly line and the manufacturing people can put the unit together, right? So those are types of AI that we use. Just in the manufacturing, and then obviously bringing it into the contact center is, it's a game changer. Being able to, serve up, natural language processing for a chat, or helping an agent out, or just as you call in and your phone tree can say, hey, what can I help you with today? Those are awesome, awesome, complete game changers from a contact center world.
When you think about bringing it into the contact center, I mean, do you think about it in that context of it's not so scary because we've been doing it here in our business?
Right. To me, it's not scary. To some people, it may be. I think you have to stay ahead of it, and you have to continuously look at what you're, I don't want to say feeding the beast, if you will. It's not something that you set it and forget it.
Yeah, I mean, some good examples of how this helps is, one of the use cases, you just want to know, customers call in, just want to know where their stuff is, right? Or what their account balance. The AI can offload a lot of those simple tasks.
Wait a minute, IVRs could do that. Give me something better.
I don't know. You know, if it's a little bit trickier, like we showed earlier, where it's not as simple as just pushing a button saying what my account balance is. Maybe
right.
You have a couple more questions that are a little more deeper than that.
That's it.
But helping to kind of solve those. But more importantly, one of the things AI is going to help us in the contact center is actually building a learning of how did that agent answer that question the last time to help answer the customer's problem the best way. Supplanting the information that agent has. Now, you know, and Ken probably knows this, agent turnover is a big problem, right? You have these people that are turning over. It's a high-pressure job.
No.
And you need to get these, people trained up and giving them additional insights that AI can bring them and say, by the way, last time this customer called, this is the best way, this kind of question or way to solve their problem. It's also supplanting how to make them a little more productive. And I think, again, back to customer experience, it all comes back to trying to solve those problems as quickly as possible.
Yeah, in our world, a customer may own one piece of equipment. They
right.
may have five or six. And if we can tell what they have and we can proactively engage them, like you were talking about earlier, snow coming very soon, right? Some areas already got some. But if we can serve up some, hey, don't forget to service
right.
your snow thrower. Looks like you're going to get some snow here in the next couple days,
Ooh, cool.
whether it's changing spark plugs or putting new fresh fuel in, any type of preseason.
Thanks
service.
For the reminder, Ken. I haven't
I'm
done
just
that.
Thinking the same thing.
I gotta go back home
I
and like fire
Hampshire.
That thing up.
Exactly. I'm thinking, okay, we got that snowblower
yeah,
thing.
Yeah. So
next topic, API, Shilly's whatnot. let's talk about APIs. I think that's something that we spoke earlier about CX. I think one of the major challenges in the industry right now is customers wanting to interact in the channel of their choice a lot of times, and that's going to have to be pulled through
right.
through APIs, whether that be through their embedded mobile app or however they want to go
right.
and approach it. Jay, do you want to tackle this?
Yeah, we have a great example of a customer. They were in Middle East. They were kind of like the DHL, a company called Aramex. And what they were finding is that a lot of the simple answers their customers wanted was, again, where's my package, where's my delivery? And what the customers would call in and they'd have agents kind of answer that question. In many parts of the world, customers are used to using different channels of communications. WhatsApp is a very popular channel of communications. And so they used our API to add a WhatsApp front end. And that WhatsApp would notify those customers that, okay, your package is ready to be delivered, or here's the date when it's going to be delivered, and reduce their calls into care by 30%. And it actually made their employees, the customer satisfaction much higher because those customers were so used to using this channel of communications. SMS also is not as reliable as we are used to in North America. In other parts of the world, SMS may not always get delivered, but WhatsApp is very reliable because based on IP channel. So they leveraged our API platform to add that front end into their contact center and it really helped improve their overall customer experience. Again, people want to communicate on the channels they're used to using day in, day out. And in different parts of the world, it may not be SMS, it may not be voice, it may not be email, it may be a completely different channel.
But that's also a great example of proactive.
And proactive,
right?
Exactly.
So all those people who don't have to call,
yep.
right? How much better do you feel when you get that tracking?
Yep.
And yet some companies do it, companies who do CX well, like Amazon,
right?
right? And some companies don't.
Yep, that's definitely true.
Before we go to the next topic, any questions in the room?
Ah.
I want to make sure that we're being sensitive to anything that's going on. Questions? Yes?
Are there recommendations, speaking of ROI and CX, where it's expenses are this to the cloud where something
So I'm going to start, and you know this, but maybe everybody in the room doesn't, right? So some of the automation that Jay talked about, it's the same kind of ROI we used to get with IVRs. You know, IVRs are not necessarily bad.
No, they're not.
Right? There were 5 to 10% of interactions that they could offload that humans didn't have to do, and there was ROI. And even when you were talking earlier, I was thinking, where do we look to what percent could we do with good self-service using AI and chatbots? I'm not saying 100%. Is it another 10%?
Yep.
Is it maybe a little bit more because we're using channels that people want to use? So I think I don't think as an industry we're measuring it. IVR was really good at measuring it. Obviously, I hate the word deflection.
Yep.
I'm talking about effective self-service. We all want to self-serve. Nobody wants to talk to their entertainment provider.
Nobody. I look forward to that. That's really great calls.
But what other ideas?
No, you know what? One thing I would say though is it's a very slippery slope though, Dan. Is like if you start trying to put the math behind it, you'll just get run away with like, well, if I do this, I can get like this much cost, and you forget what you're trying to do is solve the customer's problem in a more effective way. And that's if you just got to be really careful on trying to make a spreadsheet model. What I would like to encourage everybody to do is just do a proof of concept. Try it out. See what you find about that. You don't have to scale it on your entire company. Start at a small place. That data that you get out of that is going to be far more valuable. You'll get your satisfaction of your customers, which you can always translate into churn. You can usually translate like an NPS or a SAT score into what that means for churn, and then use that as a holistic kind of solution as opposed to just here's how many, agent time I'm going to reduce or how many agents I'm going to reduce. So, try to just bring it to real world examples.
I think part of it too is that, contact centers are typically cost centers, right? But if you build or bring in the right solutions and can show the benefit of the true 360-degree view of that customer, and then you put in the other solutions from, whatever channel it may be, phone, automated, chat, video chat, all those, I think you can drive your customer experience and satisfaction way up. And I think that's, at times it can be very difficult to put a number to.
It almost feels like, and you had addressed this a little bit earlier too, that the customer is the most important thing now, right? It almost feels like doing ROI is maybe not as important as it was in the past. But I'm gonna. Can we ask an audience person to answer a question?
Go for it. You do whatever you want. I'm not gonna tell you no.
See, you thought you were gonna heckle me, Steve, and I'm gonna turn it right back on.
Okay.
So Steve Ledden is a very well known and respected by most consultant in our space. Do you feel companies moving away from a real I have to get a return? It has to be in this. So you have a good sense of it. Interesting.
The CFO is involved to some degree on all, but the latest research we've been doing is that, to your exact point, is that CX is the most important thing and has now taken over just about every other criteria out there. So that's really the focus. But if we can create, a combination, if you will, a justify back to the CFO, just one quick example, we have a client who has to spend a lot of money right now, VMware upgrades and Citrix upgrades and Windows 7, I heard something like that. And spent a lot of money, including consulting, but we've already found him $4 million in Vonage savings, amongst other things, and ROI, and he's very happy. So
you're going to, never mind. You're not going to take $4 million away from them, are you?
Well, $399. He's very savvy about that, but again, if we can use the tools that are out there, especially the entire contact center tool set that is now available today, right, which is much richer than it was 5 years ago, right, and the whole idea of omni-channel and the appointment and, chat with the millennials, they don't talk anymore, my kids don't talk anymore, they just chat, anything along those lines, I think that really gets to, behind the scenes, I think it's still important.
One of those alerts.
But yeah, I think behind the scenes, it's got to be a combination on the front end. I mean, this is what we're doing in our practice.
No, that's why I asked you.
We're working for a CIO, okay, who, for a healthcare organization, 17,000 endpoints, doesn't see the need for contact center per se, okay, because he just has maybe a total of 40 seats and 7,000 seats in the main campus. And we told him his ratios are way off. He needs to be closer to 200 seats, you know, based upon the different departments. And so he was kind of shocked, especially when we showed him what the numbers were going to look like for contact center seats. But at the end of the day, what he did was he formed a governance committee to get buy-in, because our statement was everything is now about patient experience. And, you know, he couldn't deny that. You know, he couldn't shoot that down. And he's a very cost-conscious guy. So it was always about now, you know, driving, again, it's all about patient revenue or customer revenue in the end. So that's really what it's about, you know, amongst all of it. So he's now convinced, yeah, I may have to go to that 200 seat, actually give him a budget last week for the 200 seat contact center in the cloud. So interestingly, he's come around for someone who was in denial about anything just for a small clinical group. So if we talk, again, in our practice, we talk about patient experience, customer experience, whenever we can, as part of our language even, you know, in our discussions, and it resonates with everybody.
Awesome. So, last topic, and then we'll see if there's any other questions. We've spoken a lot about different pieces of the communication stack. So let's talk a little bit about platform. You heard Alan give his presentation earlier. You know, we've clearly seen that we want to own the whole stack of UC, CC, and APIs. What are the benefits? I'm going to present Sheila, not have JCell. So, Sheila, what are the benefits of platform versus standalone CCaaS?
So it's interesting. I woke up at, I don't know, 5:30 this morning and had this thought that the market is almost reforming in a way similar to what it was back in the 90s when I started in this business.
It's true.
Where there were PBX players. Really strong, you know, at the time, AT&T and Siemens and these guys. And there were call center players that were dedicated call center. There was Rockwell and Aspect and Technicron and these companies, right? But there were definite use cases for both, right? Those, AT&T was a big contact center plus PBX. Siemens had a great contact center plus PBX. But there was need for those standalone contact center players. I think we're reforming that right now. And we as a community are deciding who are the new leaders that are the combination leaders who bring all of those capabilities, but understanding that there's still gonna be a need for some standalone CCaaS for certain types of companies and certain. So you're not saying you're gonna take over the world and every contact center is your.
We are.
Yeah.
You didn't get that memo this morning.
I didn't get that memo, okay.
Something wrong in our branding, sorry. Let's talk to Rishi about that.
So when I started in this industry as an industry analyst, I did market share. And at that time, 90%, in 1990, 90% of every contact center license was sold with a PBX, okay? So the question is, in the cloud, does that change? I think it does. I think we may see a little bit more standalone contact centers as a service, but we don't know yet what that number is going to be. Is it going to be 75-25? Is it going to be 60-40? Personally, I think it's going to come in at about 70-30. Right, that 70% of all contact center seats. So there are 15 million contact center seats. Mm-hmm. So I'm taking your TAM down just a little, but you know, I think you got a good shot at it. Cool. So that's my sort of how I view what's happening right now. Okay. Right? And some leader, like think about it, AT&T to Lucent to Avaya managed to get through the transition of analog to digital to IP. They missed the next transition. Right? And just like Cisco emerged as an IP leader, because some companies weren't making that transition well, cloud vendors are emerging now because the premises guys just aren't making the transition.
Well, part of that is for a standalone, there's enough improvement in your CX just to marry up your contact center with your CRM. just getting all that data in one place, your communications, that's strong enough to make an improvement in your CX. And then once you unify your communications across all channels between employee and agent, that's another level. But yeah, you're right, you can completely solve, make significant improvements in how you're solving your customer's problems by just integrating, which is what cloud lets you do. All the information is cloud. With Salesforce, it's all stored in the cloud. Now once you get your telephony in the cloud, you can do some really interesting things by marrying up those insights and data that you have between those.
And to come back to APIs for a second, right? When I think about AI, one of the things I think is that in those vertical cases, they're going to be AI experts for verticals, for healthcare, for automotive, because they will build the models, the language models.
That's right.
Right? They will have the right regulatory environments for certain, for healthcare. The API side, being a platform and having those API components, means you work with the right person who has the right company that has that vertical application, that vertical knowledge, and you can do that in a way that was impossible in a premises world in terms of agility and the cost of the pro services that might be involved. I mean, just the way that you brought in new voice media, right? And within 18 months, have been able to say, we're on a path to a platform.
Communications APIs are, and ourselves and the other companies that are doing it have abstracted the difficult part of communications and made it very simple to add comms to your applications, which is a few lines of code. Encourage everybody to see some of the developer tracks here. You'll just see how simple it is just using it. It's just not us. It's everybody that's CPaaS players in this industry are making it really easy. And what Sheila's absolutely right, you can then take that, like let's say, for example, the media stream on the contact center, send it to a different AI engine. There might be a niche company that might be working on a vertical that, has very specific nomenclature or syntax that you're never going to be able to train up in a large one. Maybe even, for example, MTD, maybe the customers are asking very specific technical terms that if you take a more larger abstracted model, and the API platforms allow you to kind of take that media stream and route it to a different channel very easily. This is not like big lines of codes with a large IT staff. Anybody can code a web page, can code some of these communications applications and get that built on your whatever your need is for your customers.
So kind of want to wrap with you. You started off, I think we brought you on clearly because you're a success for what we're looking to do. Where do you go from here? What are the next things that keep you up at night?
My boys. No. I think the AI side of it is huge for the world, for MTD specifically. We have chatbots. We pulled them down because we had some issues. It was a Salesforce known issue, but anyway, put chat back up, and we're revisiting those bots, right? So menu based. I want to get to NLP, right? And how you build out that AI side of it, and then to take it further, helping the agents every day. If you can help them out by serving up, knowledge. Right, we're quite technical in a lot of the calls that we get, chats. If we can help them out quicker, better, faster, more, to decrease that call or that chat time, making sure you're doing first call contact resolution is increasing the customer experience and satisfaction is where.
Awesome, Reggie, did you get all that? Good. All right. Cool.
Right. And then the collaboration side. We're not on the UC side with Vonage, but potentially, right? So, yet.
Great. We have 2 minutes left. Any other questions in the room?
One small comment. Sorry.
No. Go for it.
Just to add, and that is that the other thing that resonates again in conversation is. And that's resonating a lot. So again, if any of us here are in sales or even internal to the organization, I think those conversations are important.
I think I'd take it a step further too, and your advocates or agents, their experience.
Yeah, that's true.
Good,
that's my customer, right? Yep. So those people taking those calls and those chats are my customer. Excellent. So yeah, it's got to be a good experience for them as well.
Great. Anything else in the room? Listen, I wanted to thank our panel today. Warm round of applause for Sheila, Ken, and Jack. Thank you, guys.